inverse of a matrix. Inverses are defined only for square matrices to begin with. And it basically says if there is A, its inverse multiplying it A on the left or on the right will give you identity matrix, which basically means that if you have AX equal to B, I can multiply on the left by its inverse. That will kind of nullify what A does and makes it identity, which does nothing. So I get X is equal to A inverse B because I'm multiplying on the left by A inverse on both sides of the equation. So A inverse is something that reverses the operation of A. The inverse in the world of matrices is similar to the reciprocal in the world of numbers. Zero doesn't have a reciprocal. So if you multiply any number by zero, it becomes zero. So you cannot reverse that operation, which is why zero doesn't have a reciprocal. Similarly, some matrices don't have reciprocals. It's not a single matrix that doesn't have a reciprocal. It's not just a zero matrix, which is singular. But other matrices also can be singular. In particular, if a row is actually zero, or two rows are the same, then those matrices are singular. So the necessary and sufficient condition for a matrix to be able to be inverted is that its determinant not be equal to zero. If A is not invertible, then it is singular, it is degenerate. Otherwise, it is invertible. It's got n pivots, it's full rank, it's a good matrix. And the system AX equal to B has a unique solution. And a fancier way of saying it is that A represents a linear automorphism that is one-to-one and onto mapping. So this is a fancy word. Again, words are not important. It's just what they mean that is important, the concepts underlying the words. So it basically means there's a transformation from a space to the same space, and it's one-to-one. One vector will transform to another vector. No two vectors will transform to the same vector. If they did, then you cannot invert it, because given the output vector, you don't know where it came from. You cannot invert it. Another way of saying it is that A square matrix is row or column equivalent to the identity matrix. If you take a non-singular matrix, do Gauss-Jordan on it, you will get an identity matrix. Now, some properties of the inverses. An inverse of an inverse is the original matrix, obviously. Scaling a matrix, its inverse gets scaled by the reciprocal of the scaling factor, which is kind of neat because that's what you would expect. Similarly, there's a product rule, kind of identical to the product rule of transposes. If you take the inverse of a product, it's the product of the inverses, but taken in reverse order. Again, you can actually prove it by just using the definition of the inverse. All these proofs will involve the identity matrix in between some other matrices. That's how you would prove all of them. A matrix that is its own inverse is called involutory. Permutation matrices implementing a single row exchange, if you want to reverse it, you just do the same exchange once more. So the inverse is the same as itself. So those matrices are involutory. And another important thing to remember is the determinant of the inverse, the reciprocal of the determinant. This also is a nice property because you think of inverse as similar to the reciprocal in the world of numbers. A inverse determinant is a determinant of A inverse. Now, this part is important. How you compute inverses. There are a couple of formulas, but the coolest way of doing it is by using Gauss-Jordan method. So what you would do is to run the Gauss-Jordan algorithm on the augmented matrix, augmented by I, A an n by n matrix, I also an n by n matrix. Just put them side by side. That is the augmented matrix. Then run the Gauss-Jordan elimination to get the RREF, reduced row echelon form. And what you will get is I on the left side of the augmented matrix, left block, and A inverse on the right block. This, you know, by running a Gauss-Jordan elimination, you know that if it is a full rank matrix, you are supposed to get I here. But what you will get on the other side is A inverse, which is quite neat. It's actually computationally very efficient. There is this finite series of row operations that you have to do before you get to the final answer. It is guaranteed to converge, computationally efficient and determined. So Gauss-Jordan is a series of elementary operations, as you know, and row operations are linear combinations of the rows. So if you think about applying Gauss-Jordan to a matrix, then it's the same as multiplying the matrix on the left by E, an elementary operator or a series of elementary operators. Okay, now that is one piece that you will use in the proof. Another piece is the blockwise multiplication that we saw in the first chapter. So if you have all n by n matrices, B augmented by C, this whole matrix is one matrix here that's got n rows and two n columns, because you have the columns of B and then you have the columns of C. And if you want to do the product, you can actually write it by blockwise multiplication. So D times B augmented by C is the same as DB augmented by DC, almost like distributing the matrix D inside. Let's say that I'm applying Gauss-Jordan to AI, A augmented by I. I know that I'll get I here, something there. I don't know what it is. So let me call it M. So this is a not an equation. This is a process step, as it were. I'm saying that I'm applying Gauss-Jordan to get that. I can make that an equation by understanding that Gauss-Jordan is an operation on the left by a matrix. It's an elementary operator, a series of elementary operations, all compacted into one, multiplying on the left. That is what's going to implement the Gauss-Jordan operation on my augmented matrix here. So then it becomes an equality. Then it becomes an equation, then I can do things to it. Okay. Now the second thing I know is the blockwise multiplication. So EAI will become EA and EI, E. And on the right hand side, right from the beginning, I have that I am. Okay. Now what I can do is to compare blockwise. So that block will have to be I. And then the second block, the green block, will have to be M. So what does that say? So I'll have to say EA is equal to I. What does that mean? Something multiplying A is giving me I. That means that something that is multiplying A has to be the inverse of A. So that means E has to be the inverse of A. That is the definition of the inverse. Now the second block tells me that E is actually M. So what I have in the position of M is actually A inverse. So that is just a blockwise multiplication and comparison block by block. Now that is the right way of computing the inverse because it's computationally efficient. But remember minors and cofactors, they can also be used to define an inverse. Minor of A11, deleting that column and that row and taking the submatrix there and finding its determinant, that would be the minor. And the minor with the associated sign is a cofactor. Once I have the cofactors, so they're just numbers, so I can arrange them in a matrix, and that matrix has got a name. We can just call it cofactor matrix C. Then you can transpose it. And that guy has got a lot of different names. It's called the adjunct, classical adjoint, adjugate, etc. Since it's got so many different names, I presume this cofactor transpose got some deep significance in linear algebra and the theory behind it. But for us, this is the only place where we're going to see it. So I'm going to use the name adjugate. So inverse of a matrix is defined in terms of the adjugate matrix, which is the transpose of the cofactor matrix. So A inverse is 1 over the determinant of A times the cofactor transpose, which is the adjugate matrix. So there is a transpose to be computed, many cofactors to be computed. So this is computationally expensive, not as nice as the Gauss-Jordan method, but this is the closed formula and nice to write it down mathematically. It looks neat, better than a Gauss-Jordan method in terms of mathematics, but computationally this is not the right thing to do. That is one part, the cofactor method, cofactor matrix, transpose of it, divided by the determinant, then you get the inverse. Although it is computationally not very nice, let's just do this for a 2x2 matrix, a general matrix. I'm not taking numbers, I'm taking A, B, and C, D. We know that the determinant is AD minus BC. Now, the cofactor matrix, cofactor of A is delete that column, that row, I get D. So that's the cofactor of A. Cofactor of C will come with a negative sign because C is in 1, 2 position. So minus 1 to the power 1 plus 2, 3. So that is minus 1. And the cofactor is, the minor is B. So the cofactor is minus B. Similarly, you get minus C and A. The cofactor transpose will become DA in the diagonal and minus C minus B in the other diagonal. So it's D minus B minus C A. That is a cofactor transpose. And now the inverse is defined as the cofactor transpose adjugate matrix divided by the determinant. So I get that, the determinant here, the cofactor transpose here. So this is something that you have to remember, not in terms of the symbols I used here, but remember it this way. In order to get the inverse of a 2x2 matrix, swap the diagonal elements. So A and D, swap them. Okay. And switch the sign of the non-diagonal elements. It was B and C. Switch the sign. Make it minus B minus C. And divide the whole thing by the determinant. These three things, steps you have to remember. So moving on from there. So if it is a square matrix and if it is non-singular, then you have an inverse. But if it is a rectangular matrix, inverse is not even defined. By the way, the inverse that we had, A inverse, I said A inverse A is equal to AA inverse equal to I. Multiply it on the left or the right, you get I. So it is called a double-sided inverse because it's the same matrix multiplying on the left or right, giving me I. That is possible only for a square matrix. If there is an inverse, it is a double-sided inverse and it's the same. That is always true. On the other hand, for a rectangular matrix, you cannot define an inverse that way, but you might still want to have something like an inverse. Okay, if M is not equal to N, this is a rectangular matrix. Let's take the example of a tall matrix, which is more important for us. So it is, suppose it's full rank. That means number of columns is less than the number of rows. A transpose A is a small matrix and it is full rank because A is full rank. A transpose A has the same rank as A. and it is invertible because it is full rank. Okay, so this guy can be inverted. So that means A transpose A multiplied by whatever inverse it has to be I. I can multiply on the left or right. I choose to multiply on the left. So if you look at that multiplication here and kind of group these guys up to here and call that something, that becomes something that is multiplying A on the left and giving you I. It is of the form some matrix B multiplying A and giving you I. So that is, in that case, I can call it A inverse. But remember, A is not square matrix, so there's no real inverse. So I should actually call it A inverse on the left. It's a left inverse. Multiplying A on the left, I get I. But if I try to multiply on the right, I cannot even multiply on the right because it is not of the right dimension. So that's the definition of the left inverse. Okay, it is called the left inverse, and it actually does something like what an inverse would do, but for a rectangular matrix. Similarly, if I take a wide and full rank matrix, then A transpose is a small matrix, and because M is less than N, so that's a small matrix and the rank is M, so this is full rank. And I have A transpose and I multiply on the right this time with its own inverse of the product, because this guy can be defined, that is I. And now I choose to look at this much, so that is something multiplying A on the right giving me I. So that's of the form AB equal to I. So B is like an inverse, but this is the right inverse. So that's the definition of the right inverse. Again, you cannot take the right inverse and multiply on the left, because the multiplication will not work.